Hi, it's John Terry, the Black Belt Leader, and I want to welcome you to Defining Your Target Market, how to get in front of more qualified prospects and to do so on a favorable basis. I want to thank you for taking time out of your schedule to join me today, and I want to get right into our training because this is really at the heart of having an opportunity to really scale your business now and in the years to come by truly understanding who it is that you want to focus with. You know, it's interesting. I just finished a coaching call earlier today talking with an individual, and we had this very same conversation you're going to hear me share with you today related to target marketing. And one of the things we were able to identify in this particular individual's practice is they were trying to target too many markets at one time. They were going so broad in their approach and in looking at their marketing didn't appeal to anyone because they were trying to appeal to everyone. So let's talk about the importance of defining your target market. And to do so, I want to open with a question. What is marketing? If you were to simply answer that question, I'm sure for those of you on the call that are joining us live and those that will be joining us later as we repeat this later in the day, you're going to have a different answer depending on what marketing is to you. Well, let me give you a very simple definition of what marketing should be, and maybe this will change your focus of how you think at marketing in your particular business. What is marketing? Simply put, marketing is a methodology that you use to attract new customers. And not only to attract new customers, but also the right type of customer. Marketing is also used so that you can stay in front of and continue to remind your existing customers of who you are, what you do, and how else you can serve them. So as you can see, marketing wears a number of hats. But today I want to focus on marketing as a methodology to do two things, to attract new customers, but also to attract the right type of customer. I mean, after all, if you don't know who you want to attract in your business, how can you effectively create the right marketing messages that's going to allow you to attract those individuals or those businesses into your particular organization? That's why Dan Kennedy says that 95% of all marketing fails. Now, think about that. Out of every dollar spent, 95 cents is essentially thrown away. Why? Because there's little or no thought into the who that you're going to market to determine what message you're actually going to be delivered that resonates with that audience. Now, far too many businesses today, as I shared in the introduction, are trying to target too broad an audience. And when you try to appeal to everyone, you ultimately appeal to no one because your message becomes so watered down. It's ineffective at reaching anyone and attracting them to do business with you. Now, if we look at the research into marketing, and there's plenty of it out there, research has shown that when you narrow your focus, you target a specific niche, you're actually going to attract more of the type of customers that you want to work with. You're going to attract the individuals who truly want and need whatever it is that you have to offer. And those individuals, when you target them specifically, are eager and willing to buy from you. Now, think about it this way. If you sell backpacks, you're going to get a much better response if you're doing your television advertising on the outdoor channel than you would if you advertised on the Hallmark channel. Now, that may seem obvious, but it's often overlooked or ignored. So while you may believe, and it may be true, that everyone can benefit from what you have to offer, the truth is this: you're going to garner more attention and more sales if you focus and narrow your niche. The riches are truly in the niches. So I want to take just a minute and talk about how you develop your unique audience. But for those of you that don't know who I am, let me quickly introduce myself. In case you don't know who I am, my name is John Terry, and I'm known as the Black Belt Leader. What do I do? Whether it's teaching you how to master your life, your leadership, communication, mindset, career, or helping your organization master its productivity, it's sales and marketing, or being able to build a highly dynamic team that creates a wow experience for your audience. I help individuals and organizations become black belt masters at whatever it is that they do. So if you want to become a black belt master at having an opportunity to do sales and marketing more effectively, you're in the right place. So I want now to turn our attention to what you need to know to be able to up-level your results in sales and marketing. And that starts with narrowing your market. Now, what do I mean by that? Targeting a specific market doesn't mean, as many people think, that you eliminate or ignore other customers that don't fit your criteria. Target marketing is simply a way to focus your marketing resources and the limited dollars that we all have into a specific market niche that is much more likely to buy your product or to utilize your service over the other markets. Now, whether you're marketing to dentists or chiropractors, people retiring, or you're selling to people that hike, whatever your niche is, you're going to elevate your brand to serve the people who are best served by your product or your service. It doesn't mean you ignore everybody else, but as you target that particular niche, here's what we find. Other people will raise their hand and say, I know you serve that market, but can you also serve me? So once you've clearly defined who your target audience is, what's often referred to as your avatar, you can now start to refine a message that's going to reach them in a powerful and compelling way. So let me first give you some questions to get you thinking about your target market and how you want to narrow that focus. So if you got a pen and a piece of paper, you might want to write these down. You can always go back and I'll share with you this recording later so you can hear this again and get these notes, but you may want to make a note of these. Question number one, what problem or problems do you uniquely solve that allow you to stand out as unique or different to your audience? What problems do you uniquely solve that allows you to stand out as unique or different? Question number two, what are the defining features of your business, your products, and your services that again make them unique? Question number three, what's the benefit to your target audience of the defining features of your business, your products, or your services? You got to remember, the individuals that you are selling to don't care about your product. They don't care about your service. They don't care about you or your business. What they care about is what your business, your product, or your service can do for them. So this third question is important because you're now speaking to the needs and concerns of your target audience. What is the specific benefit? What's the advantage that an individual gets by working with your business, working with your products, working with your services? Your clients are ultimately asking, what's in it for me? This is how you answer that question. The next question, thinking along those same lines, is this. How do you make your customer's life better in some way as a result of them working with your business, buying your products, or using your services? How does it make their life better? And the last question I want you to think about as we talk about narrowing your market, and this is the most important question you've got to be able to answer. Why should your customer or your prospective customer choose you over any and every other available option to them, including doing nothing? Why should your prospective customer choose you, your business, your product, your service, over any and every other available option to them, including doing nothing? Until you can answer those questions, you haven't been able to truly narrow your market. Now, when we think about your current customer base, this is a great starting point to really begin to think about your target audience. Now, what do I mean here? Let's take a look at your current customer base. Who's buying from you right now? What audience are you serving? And why are those individuals or those organizations buying from you? Now, that's a great question you need to be asking yourself in an ongoing opportunity to evaluate and review what you're doing so that you can continually refine what you're doing to make it better. Out of all the people you're working with, what are your favorite customers? Now, think about that. Out of all the customers you're serving, who are your favorite customers and why? What makes them unique? What makes them different? And how do you attract more people like them into your business? If you think about all of the customers that you serve, who are the ones that if you could work with them every single day, you would absolutely love it, they would absolutely love it, and you'd be hitting a home run every time you got into the batter's box and the pitcher threw the ball. It was a home run because you won, the customer won, everybody won. Now, who are those people? Out of all the people you work with, who is that unique niche of customers you love serving every single day? And why did those individuals choose you over any and every available option to them? Now, this exercise is important in thinking into your target market and how you're going to put yourself out in the marketplace, understanding who they are and why they buy from you. Because once you've identified that niche of people, now you want to start looking for patterns, common characteristics, interests that they all share, certain demographics. Maybe it's a specific age demographic. Maybe they're married or single. Maybe they're all divorced. Maybe they live in a certain geographic area. Maybe they're at a certain income level. Maybe there are other demographic qualities about them, but maybe there's some other psychographic qualities, things about their attitude, their beliefs, and other things that are non-demographic in nature that distinguish them from all of your other customers. Because when you begin to discover those unique threads about who those individuals are, you may have discovered how you can market to others just like them and attract them into your business. Now, to further refine who your ideal customer is, you want to get very, very clear on what their problems and their concerns are, as well as the goals and objectives they want to accomplish. As you're thinking into the type of customers you love to serve that get the most value out of working with you, what keeps them awake at night? What is it that you've helped them solve that has made their life better in some way? What are their goals and objectives they're trying to achieve? If you think about helping them drive the journey of life, you're working with these individuals to help them identify the potholes they don't want to hit as they're driving down the road and blow out a tire so they can't get to the destination that they want to without your help. When you understand their problems, their concerns, their goals, and their objectives, essentially getting into their thoughts and thinking what they're thinking and why they're looking to you to help them solve those problems or goals, now you begin to be able to relate your knowledge, your expertise, and your solutions and how you present them in such a way that you're going to attract the type of customer that you want to serve. Now, I said it before and I say it again, and if you have an opportunity to work with me in sales and marketing training, I'm going to beat it into your head that consumers don't care about your product. They don't care about your service. They don't care about you or your business, at least initially. What they do care about is one thing. What's in it for me? They want to know how working with you is going to solve that problem, is going to make that fear or anxiety go away, is going to give them the peace of mind that they're going to be able to accomplish a goal or an objective on time. They want to know the benefits and advantages of working with you versus your competitors, what makes you unique, what makes you different, and the outcomes that you're going to deliver that make their life better in some way. Now, that's why you need to know what your competition and your potential competition is doing, what they're offering in the marketplace, what they're saying, and how they are positioning themselves so that you truly know who you're competing against. So if you think about your market, whether you're a financial services provider, you sell backpacks, you sell investments, you sell clothing, you sell shoes, whatever it is that you sell, what is your competitor doing? And what are they saying? Who's your primary competition? Who are they serving? Who are they attracting that you're currently not, that you would love to attract and serve? What are the problems that they're currently solving that you're not, or that you can serve in a different or a better way? What solutions are they offering that you also offer that your clients may not be aware of? You want to find a niche that they're overlooking, or you want to find a way that you can position yourself as doing something unique and different in the marketplace. Your goal is to set yourself apart as unique and different, so that if everyone is standing on a stage and the audience or your customers looking at you on the stage, you're the only one with a bullhorn. You're the only one with a microphone in your hand. I like to describe it as you're the only blue duck in a pond full of yellow ducks because of the way that you stand out in your messaging and in the results that you deliver that make you unique and different. You've got to find your competitive edge if you want to be able to attract the type of customer you can best serve. You've got to be seen as unique and different than your competitors in some way. If you come in and say, I sell insurance, well, so do 100 other people in your community. You come in and say, I'm a car salesman. Well, there's a bunch of car salesmen where you live. I'm a real estate agent. Well, guess what? You're not the only real estate agent in your area. Again, you want to be the blue duck in the pond full of yellow ducks. You want to be the red umbrella in a sea of gray umbrellas. You want to be the red door in a room full of white doors. So the question is this: what is something that you bring to the table that your competitors don't? Is it knowledge? Is it expertise? What makes what you sell, your products and your services or your solutions, different, unique, or better in some way? How do you help your customer create a better outcome than the solution they're using now? Can you guarantee your results? Now, those are some powerful ways that you can begin to think about how you position yourself unique and different. And I hope by now you're beginning to see how you market and what you say in your marketing and your advertising is much more about the client's needs and concerns than it is telling them who you are and what you do. Now, some resources I want to mention that may help you find a competitive edge. I want to point you to a couple of websites, one of which is a website called Quantcast, Quantcast.com, Quantcast.com. Now, why would you want to go there? Quantcast offers free insights into traffic and looking at the demographics of over 100 million websites, what consumers are looking for and where they're going to look for that. So if you're looking to build a list to market to, what an opportunity to go there and see what people are looking for and where they're going to find it. Now, if you're familiar with Google, which most of you probably are, you can go to trends.google.com. That's trends, T-R-E-N-D-S.google.com. And there, utilizing that, again, it's a free resource, understanding where the type of customers that you want to target market are located. If they're on Facebook or LinkedIn, or they're in specific groups, or they're utilizing some other type of marketing medium to obtain information, you can find those insights at Google Trends. And there's another website that's going to allow you to identify how industries and third-party websites may have interest in what you have to offer. That website is ahrefs.com, ahrefs.com. Those are some resource tools that are available to you free of charge that you've got an opportunity to utilize as well. Now, it's important as you think about your target audience that you begin to think into demographics. Now, what do I mean by demographics? As you've gone back and you did the exercise that we talked about earlier, looking at all the customers that are buying from you now and picking out those that you love to work with, that love to work with you, that get the best results. If you could replicate that individual or that business over and over again, would that be your ideal customer? If so, that's your avatar. So what do they have in common? As we think into demographics and psychographics, there are some important things there that you need to understand. We're talking about things like age, geographic location, their gender, their income level, their education level, whether they're married or single or divorced or widowed, the type of business they're involved in or specific occupations that they engage in, and even their ethnic background. All of those are important factors to understand your who, but you need to consider other factors as well. And those are what we call psychographics. Now, psychographics refer to more of the personal, individual characteristics of a person or a group of people, not things like age and income and things that are common to everyone. These are what makes us unique as individuals. Now, psychographics are important when we're thinking about targeting when it comes to marketing, because it helps you figure out how your product, your service, your business, and you fit into a person's lifestyle, how you're going to uniquely solve their problem, or how you're going to help them achieve that goal or objective by making it personal to them. So when we think into psychographics, we're talking about things like personality, their attitudes, their beliefs, their values, their interests or their hobbies, things like their lifestyle or their behaviors. Or maybe they have a passion project that they have embraced and that's all that they're about. When you really begin to refine your target market, understanding demographics, it's not enough. You might say, I want to target moms in my business. That's not specific enough. But targeting single mothers with children in high school, now we're getting a little more specific, because not only are we looking at the demographics of mothers, but we've now gotten more specific into single mothers with children in high school, and then how your unique product or service can solve a problem or help them achieve a goal or objective. That's the goal of target marketing. Now, when I'm coaching and training clients in sales and marketing, we engage in a number of exercises similar to those I've shared a couple of with so far, simply to help you do one thing, and that's to get out of your shoes and to get into the shoes of your ideal customer. Got to remember, when it comes to marketing and targeting the audience that you want to attract, it's not about you. It's not about your product or your solution. It's about what you and your product and your solution can do for the audience that you're trying to attract. Those customers who benefit the most from what it is that you bring to the table. So by gaining another perspective, by putting yourself in their shoes, I like to define that as getting into the head of your customer and beginning to see things from their perspective. You now get a different view and a different understanding of the questions that they're asking, the emotions they're feeling, the problems they want you to solve versus the problems you think they want to have solved. When you understand what's important to them, where they want to go in life, and the things that are keeping them awake at night, and you can visualize yourself as that person, you want to be asking questions like this about your target audience. What keeps them awake at night? If you were to put yourself in the shoes of your customer, what keeps you awake at night? What is your most pressing problem right now? Again, not thinking as you, but thinking as your customer. Where does your customer want to be a year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now? And how do you help them get there? When they're looking for a solution to a need or an issue, what are the specific things they are looking for that will get them to say, yes, that's what I want? And of course, why should they choose you over anybody else? Again, getting into and viewing things from their perspective can let you get closer to truly understanding their wants and their needs. This is where doing polls and surveys with your existing clients, asking them questions such as the ones that we just posed, and getting their feedback can be invaluable to understanding how to better frame your target marketing to create a better outcome. Because until you do the things we've talked about up to this point, you really haven't defined your target audience tight enough, and you don't know them well enough to speak their language. And in your marketing, truly let them know how you can be of value to them. So market research is going to be invaluable. One of the things I teach in sales and marketing training when I'm coaching clients is the fact that you need to be doing ongoing market research with your existing customers at least once or twice a year. If it's nothing more than having a conversation with them and talking to them about what you do, why they came to you in the first place, and understanding what other problems they're dealing with in life is going to give you a revelation into other ways you can serve them and others like them simply by getting inside their head. So I touched on it, but let's go a little deeper. How do you get that information from them? Again, it can be a phone call. You can distribute a survey utilizing a variety of free survey tools and resources that are available on the internet. Or you can do a survey by phone or a survey by mail. Maybe it's email, or maybe you go on your social media platform and you post a survey or you post a quiz there. Again, maybe it's an interview with your clients where you let them know that you're trying to understand why they do business with you so that you can help serve other individuals just like them, and you would value their insights on what you're doing well, where you could improve, and other areas you're not yet serving them in that you may have an opportunity to serve them. One of the most powerful things you can do, and I've worked with a number of financial service professionals over the years, and I've challenged them to assemble focus groups, bringing in a small group of their favorite type of customer that they want to work with and putting them in a room together, doing it at a meal around lunch or meeting them for coffee at Starbucks and having a conversation, a Q&A with them and inviting them to become your ambassadors, to be advisors to you in your business, to help them identify areas where you can serve them and others like them better. Assembling these focus groups is really one of the initial steps in turning your clients into raving fans that become referral machines that introduce individuals just like themselves into your practice. Now, another helpful area when we think about target marketing is to think about the multi-stage funnel. And if you've ever been around ClickFunnels, you've heard Russell Brunson, or you've had any interest or any insights into digital marketing, you've heard about a multi-stage funnel. What is a funnel? It are the steps that you use to move a client into a sales opportunity where they're going to say yes. Prospecting, conversion, nurturing that client, and ultimately replicating that client is really what we're talking about. So maybe it's initially doing an outreach to have a conversation to individuals that you're trying to target. Again, that's where marketing comes in. Now knowing who you want to attract as a customer, your marketing now goes out on Facebook or LinkedIn, or it's a direct mail piece, or it's a radio piece, or it's a podcast interview, or it's something that you're doing to speak to the individuals that aren't yet aware of who you are and what you do, letting them know how you uniquely serve them. And then maybe from there, it's an offer to invite them to get to know you better in some way. Maybe it's an invitation to a webinar or a seminar. Maybe it's an offer you drive them to a page on your website where they can download a free report, or they can watch you do a video training class, or some way to engage with them. You then create the opportunity to drive those individuals to get to know you and like you and trust you, and you create a process and a system that moves them from just not interested at all to somewhat interested to, wow, this is good information, to I need to figure out how I can work with this individual, and then they ultimately become your client. And as you begin to think into your sales funnel and you look at different ways you're going to drive those individuals in, you want to be measuring the results so that you can see what works. As you're looking at what you're currently doing in your business, you need to be going back and looking at the different marketing strategies that you're using to see what works so you can do more of it and to see how effective it is, to see what's working okay, that maybe if you tweak it, it could be working a little better. and to see where you're essentially throwing money away by doing ads and doing marketing that isn't working and serving your interest or the interest of your customers. And once you've identified what's working, now you can do more of it. Once you've identified what you need to tweak, you can make those subtle changes, send it back out again, measure the results, and continue to refine until you get a better outcome. But the goal is continue to work on your marketing so that you can get a better result. And that only comes by doing evaluation. Because once you know who you're going to target, once you know what they want and need, you've now got to make a determination, is this market big enough for me to serve at scale? I laughed the other day when I was talking with a friend that's a dentist. And when he said, I said, who is your target market? And he jokingly said, I want to work with left-handed dentists who play golf on Tuesday. And I'm laughing at that because how many dentists do you know that are left-handed that play golf every Tuesday? It's probably not a large enough niche to go market. But the joke there was, I'm looking at trying to figure out how to make sure the audience I want to reach is going to be of sufficient size that I can spend the dollars and get a good return on my market. So as you're looking at your current market and who you're going to target, here's a couple of questions you want to ask yourself. As you look at your ideal customer, the people you love to work with, that love to work with you, are there enough people just like them that makes it worth your while to begin to market to other people just like them? Does that target audience at a broader scale have a specific need for what it is that you do? Have you taken the time to understand what's going to drive those individuals to say yes to your offer? And can they afford what it is that you sell, be it a product or a service? If you've had an opportunity to identify those areas, now it's time to actually begin to think about your marketing. So you've identified your who, your target audience. You've identified your what it is you're going to say to them, and your why. Understanding why they want to do business with you, now you've got to answer that last big important question, and that's how. Once you know who you're going to target, what you're going to say, and why you're going to say it in such a way that gets their attention, how do you get your message in front of them so they become aware of who you are, what you do, and invite them to learn more about you so they can do business with you? Until you get your message out there, you're invisible to your target audience. So one of the questions you've got to do, and that's where the research that we shared, Quantcast, Google Trends in specific, is going to help you identify where those individuals are. One of the most important questions when you're thinking about target marketing is, where are your customers going for information? Are they going to Google? Are they going to Yahoo? Are they going to Facebook or LinkedIn? Are they looking at the newspaper? Are they listening to the radio? Are they listening to podcasts? Are they following certain influencers? Where are they going for information, for education, and for entertainment? Once you know where they're going, that's where you need to show up. If your target audience is going to podcasters and influencers, then you need to start a podcast. If they go and they read blogs so that they can gain information and they're avid readers, you need to be writing a blog. If they are participating in Facebook groups and that's where they're getting information and asking questions of other individuals to help them solve their problem, you need to create a Facebook group and invite individuals in so you can share their expertise with them. It's not a one size fits all. It could be social media. It could be radio. It could be television, but you've got to get clear on your message. Because once you put your message together and you begin to put your message out there, you've only got a few seconds to grab their attention. So the message that you're going to create has got to be clear. It's got to be concise. It's got to be compelling. That means you've got to speak to the customer in their language so that they understand that you understand them. That they can say, John or Bill or Betty or whoever you happen to be listening to this podcast, they uniquely get me. They understand why I can't sleep at night. They understand why I'm anxious and I don't have the money and I want to send my kids to college, but I haven't been able to figure out how to save for that. I want to get out of this apartment I'm renting and I want to buy the home of my dreams and I don't know how to make that happen. I want to get a better job, but I'm not good on my interview skills, and I need someone to help me there. Whatever it is that you do for your audience, you've only got a few seconds in your advertising, so you've got to be able to speak uniquely to their wants, their needs, their goals, their fears, and their concerns. You've got to make sure your message rises above the noise of every other message that's out there, because everybody's advertising, everybody's marketing, everybody's trying to get the attention of the same people that you're trying to get. So your goal is to create a message that's visually appealing, that the verbiage, the words that you're going to use, speaks to your client in a compelling way. One of the most powerful ways to do that is to open with a question that relates to the client's fear or concern or anxiety. I was meeting with a coach earlier today, and we were talking about an event that he's getting ready to do, and he's going to be speaking on leadership. And when we were talking about his target audience, the individuals in his target audience want to have more influence in the marketplace. So he's going to open with a question: who doesn't want to have more influence and make a bigger impact with their customers? That's his opening salvo and his opening question. In those few seconds, what has he done? He's attracted the type of customers that he wants to attend the workshop he's going to be delivering. But at the same time, he's repelled, he's pushed away the type of people that won't benefit from his message, that he doesn't want to waste his time with because they're not a customer for what he does. That's the goal of what I mean by being clear on your message. So once you've niched down your target market, you know who you want to attract. You know what it is that keeps them awake at night. You've identified their fears, anxieties, their goals, their concerns, and the outcomes they want to achieve. You understand their why that's important to them. And now you've figured out where they are and how you're going to get to them. You've got to get clear on your message. The goal of a message is this: think of your message as how you, if you were a flower, would attract the bee to come to you to partake of the pollen that you are creating that they can take back to create honey. You want to be attractional in such a way that, like a magnet, you attract to you the type of customer that you want to work with, and you repel the type of customer that you don't. It gives you the opportunity to be unique and different about how you market so that you are much more efficient and much more effective. Most marketing tries to pull people in by preying on them in some way, and it sets them up for failure. You want to be attractional, that you invite people to do business with you in such a way that you are seen as unique and different. And once you've done your research, you've identified your audience, you've drafted a compelling message, and you've got their attention, now it's go time. It's time to invest in your marketing by going out onto the platforms where your customers are and begin to tell your story. The problem with many, many people in business is they do the homework. They get to the point they've identified their audience. They understand their why. They put together a great message, but then they want to go back and continually refine the audience and refine the message and continually research ad nauseum, that they get stuck in doing nothing because they're constantly working on honing the message. Let me tell you this up front. Your message is never going to be perfect, but if you don't get your message out there, you're never going to have an opportunity to attract the type of people who want and need what you have to offer. So one of the things my mentor tells me, he says, John, when you figured out your audience, you know what they want, you know how to speak to them in such a way that it gets their attention, you've got to climb to the top of the ladder, you've got to walk out on the diving board, and you got to jump in the pool, even if you haven't figured out whether or not you can swim. Because once you get in the water and you start thrashing around, you're going to figure it out, and you're going to get better at swimming. You're going to get back to the ladder, you're going to climb out, you're going to climb back to the top of the ladder, you're going to go to the diving board, and you're going to do it again. But this time you're going to be a little more confident because the scary part of doing it the first time is over. And then you're going to climb out, you're going to climb the ladder, and you're going to do it again. And every time you do it, you're going to keep getting better. And then the next thing you know, you're not jumping off feet first. You're diving in head first, and you're adding a flip and a twist and a turn because you've gotten really good at getting your message to your audience. So what are we trying to do in all of this? We're trying to put a message out to our clients that attract them in such a way that we want them to realize we want to take them, not to sell them something, but we want to take them on a journey of discovery. So think about your messaging this way. You're taking your clients on a journey to help them see a future version of themselves, where as you're speaking to them, you're letting them see themselves as better, happier, less fearful, less anxious, more content, more fulfilled, feeling greater rewarded, and experiencing a greater level of success in their lives, ultimately having peace of mind that you have helped them in some way make their life better. When you do that, that decision to work with you becomes one of the most important decisions that they're going to appreciate. And if you serve them well, after they say yes to your offer, you're in for an amazing experience in whatever it is that you do. Now, again, the last thing you want to make sure that you do as we start to move this to a close is you want to make sure you're monitoring your marketing so you know what's working and what's not. You want to continue to do the research because your market may not stay on one platform forever. They may be in Facebook today, but as we've seen, other platforms arise. And the Facebook market, many of the youngers moved to Instagram. And Instagram became the place to market for a season. And then many of those younger individuals and even some of the olders migrated to TikTok. There's always a new marketplace. But understanding where your clients are and where to reach them is part of the research you're going to be continually doing. You may find that if everybody has abandoned direct mail and everybody's got a mailbox, you may be able to attract your lookalike customers by utilizing direct mail when nobody else is utilizing it. You may find that an old-fashioned phone call may work if nobody's making phone calls to your clients. You may find that a video email that your customers love to receive from you that your competition's not using may give you a chance to learn. But if you're not monitoring, you're not tweaking, you're not making adjustments, and you're not occasionally trying a new thing, knowing that not everything you try is going to work, now you may get stuck in the rut of doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different outcome. That's what Einstein called insanity. So when you discover what works, you then get to decide, do I do more of it? Or maybe do I experiment with something new that may be able to reach those I haven't yet reached? That's the conversation you get to have with yourself because you're having success in your business model. Remember this, what gets measured gets managed. And when you measure your results, you better manage the outcome. And now you have the opportunity to continue to scale your results in the right direction. And once you've done everything we've talked about up to this point, you're off to the races. What have you done? And what have we talked about so far today? You've identified your target audience. You know their pains and their dreams. You now know where they can be found so you can direct your message, and you know their why so you know how to speak with them. Now, as you implement this, you're going to be attracting more of the right type of customers that you want to work with, that love what you do and the outcomes you deliver for them. And you're going to love working with them because they're the people who are best served by you and your expertise. And the rest is up to you. So as we wrap up, I want to share a couple of free resources that may be beneficial as you're thinking about target marketing and then what you do once you get them to say yes to meet with you or to engage in your business and buy from you in some way. The first of those is a free training I did a few months ago that has become one of the most powerful trainings I've done in 2021. Members of the Forbes Finance Council have commented on the value of this training and helping these high-level individuals achieve a better outcome. It's how to become an effective listener. If you want to get a better sales result, you want to serve your customers better, learning to listen when they speak is one of the most valuable skill sets that you can learn to master in your life. And if you want to master your sales and marketing, you've got to master your ability to listen. You can find that free resource at beablackbeltleader.com. Just simply go to the training tab and you'll find that free resource available right there. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention my number one new release in 2020 on Amazon. This book, Black Belt Leadership 101, was on the bestsellers list for nearly 3 months in the year 2020. If you're looking to learn to lead yourself and others well and make good choices in your business, these are the 10 essential qualities that you need to learn and adapt into your life to truly become a black belt leader in life. And if you want to connect with me on social media, let me invite you to our contact us page at beablackbeltleader.com, where you can connect with me on a variety of social media platforms, where you can subscribe to my blog. You can have an opportunity to subscribe to my podcast, check out our YouTube channel and all the other resources that we have available. Now, on behalf of all of us here at Black Belt Leadership, I want to say thank you for taking some time out to be with me today, as we've truly talked about what it means to really target your market, to refine who you serve and how you serve them. If I can serve you further, any of our team can help you, let me encourage you to reach out to me. I'd love to have an opportunity to get your insights and to hear from you what you got out of today's training. And if there's an opportunity to serve you at a better level, I'd welcome the opportunity to do that as well. So let me say thank you for joining me. I hope you have a great rest of the day. I wish you an amazing Christmas and holiday season, however it is that you serve it. Go serve your people well, and don't just be a leader, be a black belt leader.